Well, hey, welcome to Life Group 101, where I'm going to take a few minutes today to explain the vision and mission behind Manifest Life Groups, because they're absolutely critical to the mission of Manifest. If you're part of a life group, I'm assuming you are because you're watching this, you're part of something incredible that can actually be used by God to change the world. Now, Manifest Life Groups are built on the same mission that Manifest is built on. So I'm just going to write some stuff down so you can track with me today. And the mission of Manifest is simple. We want to help everyone, everywhere, discover true life in Christ. That's our mission. It's been given to us by Jesus. We're just phrasing it in a way that kind of makes sense to us. But really, that's what it's all about. Now, if you've ever come to Manifest on a Sunday morning, our Manifest mornings, we call them, the purpose of a Manifest morning is to ignite something, ignite discipleship. That means ignite your relationship with Jesus and get you on that track. Life groups have a different purpose within the mission. Their job is to shape that discipleship. What does your relationship with God actually look like? Boots to the ground with other people that can help you grow in your relationship with Jesus. Now, our DNA for Manifest, many of you have heard this before, but I'm just going to review. Our DNA from Manifest is based on a passage in the Bible in Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 17, where Jesus lays out the DNA for his entire movement. He says, "The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent," that means to change your mind and heart, "and believe the good news." The good news of Jesus, which he was beginning to flesh out with his life and he would complete with his life, death, and resurrection. I'm just going to walk you through what the good news is, because Manifest Life Groups, like everything else, are built on the gospel of Jesus. Jesus lived the perfect life that you and I could never live. And then he became the perfect sacrifice for our sins, loving us so much that he died for us, rose from the grave to defeat our greatest enemies, death, hell, Satan, all in sin, all of that. Then he sent his spirit, this is supposed to be a fire, that to dwell in us, to give us the power we couldn't live before. And then he went to heaven to prepare a place for us so that when we eventually die on this earth, we get to be with him forever. That's the gospel. And to believe the gospel fully in our lives, we need to repent. We need to have a change of mind and heart about these things. And so again, Sunday morning is meant to ignite this process. Life groups are designed to shape this process of becoming more and more like Jesus, repenting of stuff we don't believe, and then learning to believe the stuff that we're supposed to believe. Now, when Jesus said this, he said, "Repent and believe the good news," he turned to his very first followers and he said, "Follow me. Follow me." And then he said, "And I will make you." In other words, there will be transformation. Make you. And then he said, "I will make you into something particular. Fishers of men." This was the progression. Follow me, I will make you fishers of men. We're becoming something that Jesus gets to choose. Now, in terms of life groups, this is how this looks. Life groups are how we follow Jesus together. Think of them as like an extended family. An extended family, sometimes dysfunctional, not always the best, but you know what? It's what we're given, and you know you don't get to choose your family. Same deal. When you give your life to Jesus, your family with every other believer. Now, the thing that happens in a life group, when I talk about family, we're talking about community. We're talking about people that actually get to know each other. Now, every one of us have a public sphere in our lives. This is like people we might see, but we don't really know. Then there are people we see around, we might socialize with these people, but we don't know them terribly well. We're getting to know them a little bit more. And then there's people that we get personal with, that we actually might call our friends. And then there are people we get intimate with, you know, bear our deepest, darkest secrets with. In terms of following Jesus together as an extended family, life groups are the place where the social aspect of a Sunday morning becomes personal. In other words, we're not going to maybe bear the deepest, darkest secrets of our lives, but we're going to get personal so that we can receive the help that we need. If we need to go intimate, we really, really, really need to bear the secrets of our soul. Let's find one or two other manifestors, get together and do that in a safer context where that can happen. So that's what happens on the Follow Me kind of stripe. Then we're talking about being made into something. This is about transformation. And so we're learning as an extended family to, and according to the mission, discover true life in Christ. So what does that look like? Well, in these extended families, we're going to study the Bible. We're going to hear each other's stories. And we're going to pray for each other. We're going to support each other as we put shape to this discipleship, this becoming a disciple of Jesus in progressive measure. That's what we're going to do there. And the really cool thing about this section about life groups is that the focus isn't on teaching. The focus is on learning. Now, I like to teach, as you know, but that's what life groups is about. Life groups is about learning. It's about me learning. So when I go to my life group, my focus isn't on teaching. My focus is on learning. See, in the Bible, most Christians didn't get like a one-on-one mentor. Mostly, they were encouraged to do what I call one anothering each other. So love one another, bear one another's burdens, love each other, all pray for each other, care for each other. It's all of this each othering that will help us discover true life in Christ together as he makes us into fishers of men. Now, what is it, this fishers of men piece is about being on the mission together. So life groups aren't just for the people that are there. Just like the rest of Manifest, we exist for people who aren't here yet. So a huge part of this mission means inviting people into this messy extended family that's discovering true life in Christ together. That's what we're about. Now, as you invite more and more people into this circle, the need is going to grow from multiplication. So what another part of the mission is that we're going to be looking, as time goes on, for apprentices, people who are likely, you know, are going to be qualified, maybe gifted, have a passion for taking a group and starting another one. It's the most exciting thing when we get to multiply this incredible thing that God's given us and pass it on to others. So then the actual multiplication happens. This is so exciting. So we started with one life group. Now we've got two. We've got a third one on the way. And then we're going to have 4 and 12 and 55 and 168 of them. Like, who knows where God can take this? Because again, our mission is to see everyone everywhere discover true life in Christ. In just a second, I'm going to talk about how this looks on an actual evening when we gather together. Now that I've explained the vision and mission of life groups and how they fit into the bigger picture at Manifest, I want to take a little time to unpack the actual structure of life groups themselves. In other words, how they work, how they tick, and why we do what we do. In Manifest, we have 4 core values that actually shape our decisions on a day-to-day basis, and they factor into how life groups are shaped as well. So these core values are simple. That's the first one. We like things simple. We think that complexity paralyzes action, and so we try to keep things as simple as possible. The second one is organic, not like the fruit in the fruit aisle, but actually we like to take what we have and who we have and take the logical next step. That's how we define organic. The next one is reproductive or reproducible. In other words, we like to invest in things that can be done over, that can be multiplied, because this is one of the features of God's kingdom, is that the core of it is designed to multiply. And so we want to be about that as well. And the last one is revolutionary. We say that, you know what, even though we've got our little principles and our guiding thoughts, we want to give God's spirit room to do what only he can do, because that's when the true revolution happens. So those are the 4 core values that factor into life groups in a big way. And here's how they factor in. So just so you understand, we keep it simple. The key word here is Bible. In other words, we think that when we get together, that the Bible should be shaping our community and should be shaping our discipleship. Yes, there are other good books that we can read about prayer and different things, parenting, of course. But there is no book like the Bible to shape our discipleship to Jesus. That's what it's for. And it's the word of God, it's inspired, it's perfect, and it represents God and shows us how we can connect with him and put shape to our discipleship. So we want to get people into the Bible. Now, another thing that keeps it simple is we believe in a no homework policy. In other words, homework policy. In other words, we don't want to have some ongoing series that unless you do your homework when you're gone, when you come back, you're going to feel out of the loop, right? So some people skip life group because they didn't do their homework. We just open the Bible when we get together and study it. We like the leader may not have even looked at it very much more than you have. And so we're all on the same playing field. It keeps things absolutely perfectly simple. We want people in the Bible for themselves. So our method actually ensures that people, everyone in the Bible study, are actually studying the Bible, not just listening to someone talk about the Bible. Remember, it's about learning, not about teaching. So organic is the second one. And the key word here is engage. We want full engagement. We want everyone in the life group to contribute. This is organic. This is what we mean by that. So everyone's got something to learn and everyone has something to contribute. You could be a brand new believer, the first time you ever cracked open a Bible. Do you know that because God's Spirit is in you and is inspiring his word, you could have an insight that everyone in the entire group needs to hear. So we want everyone to be engaged, everyone to weigh in. It's organic. It's about the people. It's about the people in the group. Okay, so that's huge, 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 huge. Now, the other one is reproductive or reproducible. And this one's awesome because this is three words. You can do it. In other words, this isn't dependent on massive gifting or huge Bible knowledge or anything like that. What we're doing is we're opening the Bible. We're all taking the posture of a learner, which means no one has to be the expert. So we're learning and we're weighing this as we go, which means you don't have to wait for some massive Bible scholar to come along before you can multiply life groups. In other words, as long as people are opening the Bible and learning to study it, we can do this. In fact, what else would they have been doing in the New Testament when there are thousands of believers and home groups are multiplying? They couldn't possibly have had a scholar in every group. This levels the playing field again. Also, in revolutionary, in this kind of value, we want to give God room. So here, just a couple of words too. Give God room to do his thing. And we believe that by letting everyone contribute and having everyone listening to God for themselves, we give God the space to do that. So that's in a nutshell how these values play into shaping our life group experience. Now, on a long-term basis, there are three important elements that life group leaders are going to make sure are in kind of a rhythm. And it's up to every life group and every life group leader to decide how many of which go and how which order and all that kind of stuff. But the rhythm goes like this. And again, it's based on this. So number one, we're going to make sure that there's a significant amount of actual Bible study. So you might have one or two in a row that are Bible study nights. That's the second one is we also want to take time to hear each other's stories. The Bible models this so well that when people share their stories, and even Jesus would experience something with his disciples, he'd take time to unpack it with them, unpacking their experience. So we want to unpack people's experience, again, linking it to what the Bible says about their experience and what the Bible, the gospel in particular, has to say about their experience. And the third one is kind of an invite night. I was going to say outreach, but we're asking people to come to us in this case. So that every so often in your life group, in the rhythm of your life group, there will be nights designated as social nights, games nights, whatever. And this is a perfect time, if you haven't already, you can do it any week, if you haven't already, to invite people into the life group that haven't been there before. Again, our focus is on people who aren't here yet. This is for them. So that's the bigger picture, okay? Now, what I'm gonna do next is I'm gonna unpack what I call the manifest Bible study method. What you're gonna get in your small group is every participant is going to get a book called My Small Group Bible Study Journal. And basically this book, journal is a book of blank pages. and it's got places to write different things, and just let me explain it to you so you understand what's going on. You'll start your life group in a large group. Everybody will be gathered together, and your small group leader, whoever's facilitating that night, will give you something to start with. What he's going to give you or she's going to give you is a Bible passage. In other words, she'll tell you or he'll tell you what the passage is you're going to be studying, the part of the section of scripture you're going to be studying that night. And they're also going to give you a keyword. The keyword is important because if you've been studying the Bible a long time, you tend to go to the things you already know about the Bible instead of learning something, and you start to teach instead of learn. Also, if you're brand new to scripture, just opening up the Bible and starting to read can seem intimidating. If you say, we're going to learn about love today, okay, then I can look for that, right? And so it kind of levels the playing field when you start giving a keyword. Now, if you come up with something that is not part of the keyword, it's okay, all right? But just give some focus to this. So then what'll happen in your groups is you're going to break up into groups of three or four. Five is pushing it because it changes the dynamic. The reason we break into smaller clusters is because in many group settings, extroverts do all the talking and the introverts kind of go, yeah, what he said, what she said. And they don't feel like they're comfortable enough to voice their own opinions. But we're looking for maximum engagement. And the best way to do that is to create smaller environments where introverts feel comfortable knowing that they've got something valuable to share. So we're going to break into groups of three or four. You can break up into different places in the home to do this, upstairs, downstairs, kitchen table, dining room, whatever you want to do, just so that there's enough space that you can actually have your separate experiences. And then in the first 5 to 7 minutes, you're going to do something called look for 5 to 7 minutes. This is the next section in the book. And this is where you're going to record your own insights and questions and, hey, that's a really cool word, or I wonder why he said that, or this reminds me of this verse, or whatever your observations are, because we're inviting God to speak to us through his word, so that we're going to talk first about looking. We're going to actually read it for ourselves. Look, look, look. And I'm going to say something here. Actually write it down. Okay? After a couple of weeks, you're going to be like, yeah, I got this. No, please write it down because you're not going to remember everything that you said. Plus, other people in the next section are going to be weighing in, and I want you to write their stuff down because it also communicates to them what they're saying is valuable enough to write down. Okay? So write your stuff down because in your personal study, quietly to yourself, you're going to come up with a couple of things. Then we're going to enter a listen phase. And the listen phase is 15 or 20 minutes where we're going to spend time talking together about what we found. So after a super awkward silence, 5 to 7 minutes, someone's going to go, okay, so what did we find? And here's where someone's going to say, well, I thought it was really cool how they used this word. And another person says, yeah, well, I had a question. What about this? Another person's going to say, well, I learned that God is like this. And isn't it neat? And as you're going through this, you're making notes. You're writing things down because you're listening now to what other people found, assuming that God is going to speak through anybody and everybody in the group. As you're listening to them talking, combining with the stuff that you're contributing, you're going to be asking yourself a very important question, and that is, God, what do you have for me today? What is it that you're trying to say? Okay? So in the listen section, you're listening, you're unpacking. What do you mean by that? Could you explain what you mean? You're asking all these questions. Again, not teaching, learning. And as you're listening, you're learning. And then there's a really thin section here, and this is the takeaway section. This is super important because there's not much room. And the reason there's not much room is your takeaway should be simple. It should be clear. In other words, don't just walk away going, wow, that was super interesting. Lots of pertinent information. Go, God, what is it for me? Is there something I'm supposed to look into? Something you want me to pray about? Someone you want me to talk to? So let's say my takeaway is, oh, I need to apologize to my wife. I really was sharp with her, and this passage that we're reading really taught me about forgiveness, and I need to go and I need to make things right. So I write that down here. This is my takeaway. Okay, as specific as possible so that I can know whether I've achieved it or not, whether I've actually done it. The next phase is really important as well, and there's a prayer section. And so in your cluster, often you'll have time to pray for each other, especially if you don't just let this go looping and looping and looping and rehashing things. At some point, somebody's got to say, okay, it's not just about information, what's your takeaway? And what we do in our group is we take turns. What's your takeaway? Well, my takeaway is this. I think mine's this. I don't know what my takeaway is. Okay, let's pray about that. And we go around the little cluster. There's the takeaways. Because in our prayer time, we then pray for each other about those takeaways. So somebody in my group is going to say, please, God, would you give Brad the wisdom and the grace to go and apologize and humble himself to apologize to his wife, Shauna. Someone's going to pray that for me in that time. Now, you could add things to this, like personal things that weren't part of the study. Absolutely. But it's critical that we take what we've seen in God's word, what we've heard God saying to us, we believe he wants us to take away. It's critical that we pray that into our actual lives. Because the point is that God wants us to get us doing what we've seen and heard. Now, if you're wondering if that sounds familiar, that sounds like somewhere in the New Testament. Yes, it's from James chapter 1, verses 22 to 25, where James talks about looking into God's word, listening to what it says, and putting it into practice. So that's what this is based on. Now, again, what's going to happen is you're going to get to the end of this time together. What we do in our group is not every week, but often we'll then come back together into the larger group. The little clusters come back together and we compare notes. The beauty of doing this is the groups rarely are focused exactly in the same way. So one group will say, well, we really focused on this. And the other group will go, huh, that's cool. We took this approach. And you'll learn again some things about what to talk about. And then you can sometimes do a larger group prayer and wrap it with a bow, you know, that kind of thing at the end of the evening and break for snack. However you want to do it, right? But this is the Bible study method that Manifest has chosen. And it's incredible because what we see is everybody's engaged somehow. We're actually studying the Bible. Even new believers are studying the Bible for themselves. It's reproducible and it gives God space to speak through his children to each other. So that's the Manifest vision and mission of life groups and how we do life groups in a nutshell. There's more to it than that, but there's a lot of latitude for life groups and life group leaders to kind of mess with the formula within these guidelines. But it's important that we stick to this because, again, life groups are designed to shape discipleship. If we just let them run and do whatever they want to do, we end up hitting nothing over time. So we want to stay focused so that Sunday mornings can be focused on igniting discipleship, getting things fired up inside of us, making connections we've never seen before, huh? And then in life group, we can put shape to it and work it out and figure out how it's supposed to look, takeaway, in our actual lives. So enjoy that. And if you really want to kind of dig into this deeper, what you could do tonight, if you have time, is open Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47, and look at the early church and how these elements work together that we've been talking about in this video.